One of the items on my bucket list is to see a concert using that weird hologram technology. I find it fascinating from a tech perspective and from a performance perspective as well. Now, the most recent use that drew my attention was, of course, the Splatoon sisters, but they're not the first characters that come to mind. It is, of course, the famous virtual idol, Hatsune Miku. But with no plans of an English show anytime soon, I'll have to find other sources for consuming Japanese virtual idols. And don't take that out of context, please. Hatsune Miku, Project Diva X, released on August 30th, 2016 for both North America and the European Union on the PlayStation 4 for $49.99 and for the PlayStation Vita for $39.99. I played the PlayStation 4 version for this review and logged over 45 hours of the game, completing the main story as well as finishing all songs at the hard difficulty or higher. But here's the question. Will the spotlight shine on Miku once again, bringing more of what its series fans want? Will it be able to appeal to an even bigger audience this time around? Or will it stumble at its own beat, unable to keep up the rhythm that the series is known for? That's what I'm here to find out, but before I begin, this game was received from PlayAsia as part of their partner program. That won't change my opinion of the game in the end, but you should know that because of FTC guidelines, as well as the whole morals thing, you know? And for the new folks to the channel, note that on non-mobile devices, you'll be able to move around in the review when these sections of the video come up. For mobile users, the timestamps are in the description down below. With the logistics out of the way, let's get into the rhythm with animated idols, dancing, and various animal parts. While it's mainly there to loosely tie together the rhythm gameplay, let's start with the story to provide the background for the rest of the review. Immediately starting off by taking the fourth wall and chucking it into the nearest trash bin, Project Diva X's characters and world know exactly what they are: a game. But that doesn't change the fact that these characters, including Miku herself, need your help. Their world is powered through their songs, and they can only sing if you're there to help people hear it. So, it's your job to assist the girls in powering up their world once again through the power of music and dance. Because everyone knows that every form of music has a bit of necromancy deeply embedded within it. The world is divided into various clouds, representing auras of the idol's performance: classic, cute, cool, elegant, and quirky. These clouds have the appropriate songs corresponding to the core aura, and you'll have to perform them to power them up using voltage. During this time, the girls will learn a little bit on the way about how to perform for that specific aura, in a family sitcom kind of way. This story is bare bones and dramaless. If you're expecting any sort of drama or anything related to conflict, you've got another thing coming. Basically, these story sections teach life lessons. For example, being yourself or the power of friendship. It's all about the warm and fuzzies here, and not much more than that. The characters will thank you for your help occasionally, and it all leads to a climax. That's not really a climax. Needless to say, the plot isn't this game's strong suit, and you should know that going in. Now, as to the characters and writing itself, time for a tiny confession. I haven't played any games with Hatsune Miku before. I've seen some YouTube footage, as I mentioned before, of the concerts, but trying to analyze if this iteration of Miku fits with all the other iterations, I'm not exactly your guy. With that said, the characters seem to be all sorta basic. Rin and Len are twins, but not really, that get into mini fights. Miku is the kind and perfect protagonist that always wants to get better and loves to sing. Maiko and Kaito are semi-mentor types. They seem to be twins, but not really, maybe they're just mirrors of each other. And Luca seems to be the closest thing to a rival friend that Miku has. The writing isn't anything to write home about, if I haven't made that obvious, as even the humorous sections of the game sort of fall flat, at least for me. Honestly though, the game's story is there to loosely tie together the gameplay, so the effort wasn't placed here in my opinion. Just be aware of that going into the gameplay and presentation sections. With that out of the way, let's get to one of the cores of the game, its gameplay. You'll notice that there will be a lot of crossover between the presentation and gameplay sections of this review. That's because Project Diva X is a rhythm game, and thus, it's so reliant on the music and core gameplay working together in harmony. And I'm happy to say that for the most part, Project Diva X does the job. It does have some stumbles along the way, however. So, it's a rhythm game. You'll hit the appropriate buttons based on what appears on screen, and you'll have to do it in the appropriate time along the rhythm of the song. You'll be rewarded voltage, aka points, based on how close you got to the exact timing, with ratings ranging from cool to downright missing a note. There's of course a combo meter, and the game incentivizes you to keep combos going as long as possible. In addition, the game of course doesn't just have single notes, as you'll have rush sections and hold down sections as well. Now with that said, that's all pretty standard for the genre. There's two other elements that make up the basic gameplay here, however. There's technical sections, which reward you with extra voltage if you get through them by hitting every note above safe rating. Miss one note, and you lose the voltage bonus. In addition, you've got something called chance time. Chance time will reward you with a random module, aka a costume, for your character. I'll go more into modules later, as they do have an effect on gameplay. So, in terms of the rhythm gameplay, it's on point. One of the biggest measurables for me in games like this is how closely the rhythm of the song follows the actual button combination timing that the game asks for at its different difficulty levels. And for about 98% of the cases here, Project Diva X knocks it out of the park. Even if I get lost in some of the busy visuals, I can usually make my way through the section without exactly seeing which note I'm hitting the button for, because I can use the music's beat and the general location on the screen to know when to hit it. That puts the emphasis on the music, which is why you're playing the game in the first place. You find yourself tapping your foot to the beat, lost in trying to match every note, and almost zoning out from the world around you. Project Diva X has that elite beat agents element to it, something that may have simple gameplay elements, but it's so enjoyable thanks to good feedback being instantly given to you. You are always aware of how you're doing and how you can improve. On a side note, maybe it's been a while, but I found Project Diva X actually did it better than some of the other games in the genre out there. I like the fact that when I timed the note just right, but hit the wrong button for example, the game gave me a rating with a question mark. It told me that I was on point rhythm-wise, just that I needed to actually hit the right button. Again, that feedback loop works perfectly in this case. Now I'll get to the actual song variety in terms of the enjoyment of the music in the presentation portion, but in terms of the gameplay, there is good gameplay variety within these songs. Well, as much as you can expect from a rhythm game. There's a good mixture of high and low BPM, aka beats per minute songs, allowing for quick frenetic gameplay at some points, but then turned around and slowed down for precise timing sections. No two songs feel alike, even with the 30 songs that the game presents. Now granted, I did want more songs in the long run, but I can't say you don't get your money's worth here. Difficulty-wise, you got a good range of easy to extreme modes. Easy holds your hand and focuses on very distinct button presses at a relatively slow pace. It's a good entry point for those who are unfamiliar with the genre, although veterans are going to want to ignore it. Now, normal seems like a good baseline difficulty, but there is a small complaint here. Why is the hard mode not unlocked by default? Veterans of the genre will have to play the game entirely on normal first, and with a game like this, I just don't see the point of forcing that on them. Meanwhile, Extreme will test not only your ability to rhythmically tap to a fast beat, but it'll also test your memorization skills as well. Hard and extreme difficulties have sections that a normal human can't react to on a one-note basis, as a normal human reaction time is a quarter of a second. So you'll need to realize what series of notes is coming and pull them off all at once. This will take practice in several cases, and there are sections of a couple of these songs that are downright brutal. And that's somewhere where I'd like to see future iterations of the game improve. Now, Project Diva X is actually a bit better in terms of practicing than games like Elite Beat Agents. The reason being, you don't automatically fail a song if you can't beat the required voltage score. Which is nice, because one of the issues I've had with other rhythm games is that slow progression, where you finally get past one section of the song that's been kicking your butt, only to be hammered by the next one. That's not the case in Project Diva X, as the bottom of the screen always shows you how far you are to completing the song's score pass limit, so you can give up if you're not going to make it, but you can keep on going if you want to practice more and more. With that said, I still would have liked to see a mode where I can actually practice a particular section of a song that's been kicking my butt. I'm not sure why this isn't a thing in rhythm games, but I'm begging developers to make it a standard. I'm still having problems with this section of this extreme song. Look, I'm 30 years old. Maybe my skills aren't what they used to be. But no matter what I do, I can't get the timing down using these broken down fingers, apparently. In addition, one big factor in games like this is replayability, and that comes in two different forms. First of all, are the songs on their own fun enough to want to play over and over again? In Project Diva X's case, yes they are. I had no problem redoing songs over and over again, and there was enough song variety that I moved on when I felt like I mastered a particular one. Secondly, the game does have some replayability beyond the score chasing and collection of all the modules after you beat the main game. You'll unlock some new modes for the specific songs that drastically challenge you in different ways. Take the ninja mode here, where the notes disappear as they get close to the target, making you totally reliant on the rhythm of the notes. Now, this is specific for each song, as the different modes aren't available for each individual one. And I can understand why, because some of them would make that specific song literally impossible. Moving on, this wouldn't be a game with virtual idol waifus without the ability to dress them up in silly costumes while they perform. Each character can choose a base module, aka costume, going into a performance, which has two attributes. The first is its unique perk, which provides specific bonuses to gameplay, such as raising the voltage rate for hitting specific combos, or making it easier to pick up a rare module drop. Secondly, each costume has a base aura attached to it. That aura will give you a voltage benefit based on the aura it matches of the song you're about to perform. You also have four different accessory portions that you can add on to your character with as well, and they hit the gambit from serious little additions to make a costume to, of course, the downright bizarre. Now, the game does give you incentive to try to actually match these items together with set bonuses, such as putting all metal items together. But sometimes, it ends up with some weird voltage combination bonuses that really don't make sense. Apparently, actually matching the dog-themed elements of this character's accessories is less than the mishmash of other animal parts. That doesn't really make sense, but I suppose it's a minor complaint in the big picture. And don't think that these are just tacked on bonuses. If you can get a significant set bonus and the right perk going into a song that's giving you trouble, you can actually end up turning a failure into success. Keeping at trying to find new modules and getting bigger set bonuses is encouraged, and hoarder type players, you'll love trying to find all these modules. That's an enhancer to the score, which will come up in the overall conclusion of this review. Just be aware that certain combinations of modules with certain songs will cause you nightmares. You may think this is a joke, but no, I'm doing this as a PSA, because the combinations you make and the songs performed may end up burning images into your brain that you'll never get out. I'm Beyond the song gameplay, there's also a friendship portion, where you give people random gifts that randomly drop in the songs to level up your friendship with them. Because, well, who doesn't like gifts and buying friendship? Joking aside, it's a nice little side element to the game to interact with these characters, but it also seemingly has benefits gameplay-wise, although I haven't figured out exactly what those are. Things get easier in terms of gameplay, but it's hard to specifically measure. The gifts you give and how effective they are will be based on the item and personality of the character, which can be hard to figure out actually. As I mentioned in the story section, some of the characters are hard to define beyond basic personality quirks. But I'm going on record that these characters in general are incredibly vain. They are always happy to get items of themselves, no matter what it is. Anyone else think that's silly? I think that's silly. There's also a video editor in case you want to make your own videos in game, as you can control the camera angles, spot and stage effects, and the lighting. You can create your own Miku music video. It's not bad for a small side change of pace feature. To sum up the gameplay, it's rock solid in the genre. It makes slight improvements here and there from other games that I've played, but it doesn't necessarily blow me away at any point. It's above average, and considering the niche of the genre itself, it's definitely got its place within the current gaming landscape. Now, the technical section of this review will be brief, mostly because, well, this is a rhythm game, and that means that the gameplay is critically reliant on the game's performance, the whole timing mechanic that comes into play and all. As mentioned, I played the PlayStation 4 version of this game, but there is a Vita version as well, and both have strengths and weaknesses that may make you consider one over the other. The PlayStation 4 version, despite the footage shown here, runs at 1080p and 60fps. Sorry, the capture device that I use only goes to 30fps for most cases on my consoles, and I don't have the finances to upgrade at this point. The performance is rock solid as you can get here, however. There's minimal loading times, there's no FPS drops, and the game runs as smooth as silk. It's everything you'd want out of a rhythm game performance-wise, and I experienced no bugs during my gameplay sessions. The game also did get a graphics upgrade on the PS4, despite the cross-platform nature, and it's pretty significant as shown by the side-by-side footage here. With that said, with the gameplay being as simple as it is, the portability of the Vita version may make you want to choose that version over the PS4. There is cross-save loading here, and based on TechRaptor's James G, it works well even with imported versions of the game. By the way, you should probably check out his review after you finish this one. I'm just saying, it's a good review. Basically, if you were worried about performance, don't be. Project Diva X delivers. Now, as I mentioned in the gameplay section, there's such a synergy needed between the gameplay and the presentation within a rhythm game. If one suffers, the other one does. Project Diva X understands this and put its effort into the right places for the most part. The presentation as a whole does work, although like with the gameplay, there's small little things that hold it back. Let's start off with the gameplay visuals. You get a mix of 3D models along with 2D artwork for specific cutscenes. As you would expect, the Japanese animation influence is strong, with many of the characters taking advantage of large anime eyes and typical Japanese anime tropes. The models themselves are simple, yet they have an elegance to them. The coloring of characters and its shade work is basic, but in a good way. Now granted, you won't get a whole lot of detail at times with this art style. This goddess costume, for example. The scarf gives off a cloud-like feel, but looking at it closely, it doesn't have the look of a soft texture. But on the other side of the spectrum, the headpiece cloth's porcelain transparency gives the feel of a fine fabric. It's this inconsistency that can be bothersome, but if you don't look closely at these models, you probably won't notice. I do want to give special mention to the 2D artwork of the song selections, because not only is there a variety of styles here, they all are pretty fantastic drawings. Granted, I'm much more appreciative of artwork like this because, well, everything I do drawing-wise looks like a tragic farming accident. But nevertheless, I love this artwork and the menu implementation as a whole. Getting in and finding a song was quick and easy, and everything felt natural in terms of its presentation. In terms of the quality of animation, when it comes to these characters, it's definitely there. While you're trying to catch the rhythm as best as you can, Miku and her friends aren't going to just stand around and just sing without some heart put into it. Each song has a choreographed dance to go along with it, to try to match the style or themes of the song. You'll have your standard jumping around and twirls that probably would make me sick if I did them, but you've also got some unique ones in things like the Hansel and Gretel section. These are clean and rather fun to watch, even if you're supposed to be focusing on hitting buttons at that moment. Again though, the small details are where things get a little bit iffy here. Giving a character a drink, for example, in the friendship mode, and them drinking out of a cup that never empties, feels off. I know that seems like a minor complaint, but when it contrasts against the solid animation work with the bodies, it just stands out that much more, especially when you start to see clipping within the costumes that you may have chosen on top of it. In terms of the gameplay, the game button choices and background work all give a great presentation for the most part. The streak of a rainbow button during a chant section works nicely, and it can be really complemented by what's going on in the background. Again, the rhythm really plays a big part in this. The visuals and the motions match what you're hearing for the most part, and gives a real-life concert feel, even if these characters and gameplay are virtual. Now, I mentioned in the gameplay section that I have a small caveat with the rhythm gameplay, and here it is. There are times where the game's visuals and gameplay work against themselves. There are some combinations of background colors and activity that makes it really hard to see where a note is coming from because it ends up blending into the background while it's moving. The problem here is simple. The shades of coloring used on the main notes are similar enough to the colors in the background that they don't always stand out. And sometimes, there's just way too much going on in the background that your eyes have no idea where to focus. Let's take an example of two stages of the same song of what I'm talking about here. Take this stage. While there is stuff going on in terms of dancing and background chaos, it doesn't overshadow the main gameplay mechanic. This is a good example of aesthetic working with the gameplay. Now let's take that same song and combine it with this stage. And notice the difference. Note how some notes end up almost getting drowned in everything else happening. This is what I'm talking about. And it's not necessarily the combinations either, it's just that some stages are too busy. Look what's going on in the background over here. There's just too much going on. Let me focus on the performance. Okay, visuals aside, the meat of the presentation has to be the sound portion, because, well, rhythm gameplay. But let's start with the voice acting. There's a synthetic portion to the voice acting because the characters are vocaloids. In terms of the voice acting, it's little quips more than anything else outside of gameplay. You're not getting full text here, but rather more sounds that are appropriate to the character. I mean, it works to a certain extent, I suppose, but just take a listen to what I'm talking about here. But that does not apply to the actual song performances, because, well, as you can expect, the music is really well done here and professional. You hit a wide variety of ranges at times, different speeds, and it's clear that the voice actors could get up on a stage right now and blow the audience away with their vocal cords. All the songs are in Japanese, so anybody looking for English song version dubs need to look elsewhere. But given the types of songs they are, I'm not sure if that could work with the English dubs with the gameplay anyway, considering the rhythm and wording that goes along with the rhythm gameplay. In song, there's nice little design implementations here that may be standard for the genre, but are still nice to see nonetheless. Missing a note will actually affect Miku's singing, as she can't be heard when you mess up a note, leading to an awkward yet appropriate performance. As to the song variety and quality, the game truly has some variety in song types and styles, even within the different auras that the game presents. From songs about love to ninja-style duets, there's songs that I truly enjoyed playing repeatedly. They've got an addictive quality to them, which is what you want in a game like this. They hit a real wide range as well, switching through J-pop, rock, more classical, and ones that I don't even know I can define. Again, I have to emphasize the variety here. The instruments, the tones, the beats per minute, they all really work nicely to give a good collection here. Now granted, I haven't played other games of this series, so I can't say if it's better than those. But take a listen to some of my favorites here, because well, they really can get you off your feet and dancing like an idiot in your own room. But out of every 7 or so songs, there's a real stinker here. In particular with the quirky style. I mean, don't get me wrong, everyone's gonna have a favorite or two in any song collection. But I have to question a couple of the choices here. Even rhythm game wise, they don't fit as they have awkward rhythms or not easily identifiable rhythms. And just, well, take a listen to exactly what I'm talking about. Despite those blunders, however, the presentation still is on point here. I loved playing this game, I loved watching this game, and in particular, I loved listening to this game. In the end, Hatsune Miku, Project Diva X, delivers what you'd want out of the genre, but it isn't necessarily going to blow you away in the genre either. Most likely, if you're looking at the game in the first place, it's probably the type of game that you're going to enjoy. It's the definition of solid across the board. It scores an 83 out of 100 on my scoring scale, meaning that it's a solid buy, unless you're hurting for cash. But as always, my larger reviews have something called enhancers. Basically, these are score adjustments based on what kind of gamer you are. They aren't going to apply for everyone and can be more subjective in nature. So only apply these scores if you squarely fall into the category. If you have any question about it, don't apply it. Hell, you can ignore it completely if you want a more standard review. But this channel is about matching the gamer with the game, and there's so many different games out there and so many different types of players out there. Now that you have everything you need in terms of making a purchase decision, time for some shameless self-promotion. There will be affiliate links for those who want to pick up the game in the description below, along with a promo code as part of a partnership with PlayAsia. That helps the channel out financially, but again, only pick up the game if it's truly something that you want. And as always, I recommend reading a couple of reviews before making a purchasing decision. Not that I'm not confident in my own review and opinion, far from it, but even the best reviewers can miss things at times or focus more on one aspect. For that secondary review, I check OpenCritic, where you can customize which reviewers you trust and throw away those you don't. I'm part of their contributors program over there, which allows me to be alongside the biggest fish in the pond. And no, this is not a paid advertisement. I just think the service is actually giving you value. Anyway, thanks for watching. Coming up next on the channel will be my Deus Ex Mankind Divided review, Mystery Chronicle One Way Heroics review, and of course, Overwatch Friday. And something called Stranger of Sword City that keeps on getting delayed. I understand, I need to get that game done. And maybe some other surprises along the way. I'll see you later. In the meanwhile, I'm gonna take up drinking, hoping to cleanse myself from some particular images. Because she haunts my dreams and my nightmares. Thanks for watching. Like the video, share it with a friend, and subscribe if you want more content like this. In the description below, you'll find the Steam review accompanying this vid, along with social media that you can follow me on, Twitter, Google+, and Facebook groups. And if you want to support the channel, click that Patreon on the left of the screen. And remember, keep on gaming.